Hello friends, you are watching Pathology Discussion Forum. I am sorry because after 16th June, I haven't posted a single video. I was quite busy at work and also made a short trip to Darjeeling with my friends. Believe me, that trip was awesome. We were literally amazed after experiencing such scenic beauty. After the end of this session, I will share a few glimpses of that journey with you. If you haven't subscribed to our channel, then press the subscribe button below to get our videos instantly. So before wasting your time, let's move on to today's topic. Today I'll talk about reticulocyte. Reticulocytes are the young red blood cells released from marrow into the bloodstream. Contain remnants of RNA and ribosome, but no nucleus. In Romanowsky stained blood smear, it appears as polychromatic red cells. That means it has a greyish blue color. After staining with a supravital dye such as new methylene blue, the RNA appears as blue granules or filaments within the reticulocytes. According to the College of American Pathology, after supravital staining, any non-nucleated red cell with two or more granules or filaments is considered a reticulocyte. Now, do you know what is supravital staining? Supravital staining refers to staining of a cell in living state before they are killed by fixation or drying. Now let's talk about the importance of reticulocyte count. It is performed to assess the erythropoietic activity of bone marrow. That means how efficiently our marrow is producing RBCs. It is used to differentiate between hypoproliferative anemia from hyperproliferative anemia. In hypoproliferative states like aplastic anemia or ineffective erythropoiesis, the reticulocyte count is low due to decreased production of red cells. On the other hand, in hyperproliferative states such as hemolytic anemia or during recovery from acute blood loss, our marrow tries to compensate by increasing the RBC production, which results in increased reticulocyte count. Also, it helps to assess the response to erythropoietin therapy in anemia of chronic renal failure in the same way. Increased reticulocyte count indicates positive response to therapy. Following bone marrow transplantation, an increased reticulocyte count confirms the engraftment of transplanted marrow. That means the transplanted marrow is now doing a great job. Also, it helps to assess the recovery from myelosuppressive therapy. Now let's move on to the stages of maturation of reticulocytes. Stage 0 is late or orthochromatic normoblast with strong staining. Sometimes this stage is not considered as reticulocyte at all. Stage 1 is identified by presence of dense cohesive reticulum in non-nucleated red cell. Stage 2 has extensive network of loose reticulum. Stage 3 has small reticulum along with small granules. And stage 4 has scattered granules only. Now let's move on to the causes of increased reticulocyte count.
The causes are hemolytic anemia, blood loss following specific therapy of nutritional anemia and hemoglobinopathies.
Now I will talk about the causes of decreased reticulocyte count.
The causes are aplastic anemia and pure red cell aplasia, bone marrow infiltration in case of leukemia, lymphoma, myelofibrosis, renal disease, anemia of chronic disease, alcoholism, etc.
Now let's talk about the measures of reticulocyte count.
Now reticulocyte count. This is the number of reticulocytes counted amongst 1000 red cells and expressed as percentage. So the reticulocyte count is reticulocyte counted divided by the number of red cells multiplied by 100. In adults and children, the normal reticulocyte count is 0.5 to 2.5%. In newborns, the reticulocyte count is 2 to 5%. Corrected reticulocyte count. This is the reticulocyte count corrected for the degree of anemia. Now absolute reticulocyte count. This is the number of reticulocytes in 1 cubic millimeter of blood. Now, what is reticulocyte production index? After the formation in bone marrow, the reticulocytes normally spend about 2 days in bone marrow and 1 day in the peripheral blood before they are fully matured to red cells. However, in severe hemolytic anemia and acute blood loss, the reticulocytes are released prematurely in the peripheral circulation, where they require more than 2 days for maturation. This results in doubling of reticulocyte count. In such cases, to avoid the overestimation of daily red cell production and to get an idea about the actual erythropoietic activity, reticulocyte production index is derived. The formula is reticulocyte production index equals to corrected reticulocyte count divided by the maturation time in days. Maturation time in days according to PCV are, if PCV is more than 35%, it is 1, 25 to 35% it is 1.5, 15 to 25% it is 2, and 5 to 15% it is 2.5.
Sometimes reticulocytes may be confused with some RBC inclusions Now let me tell you how to differentiate reticulocyte from RBC inclusions.
The first one is Heinz bodies. These are precipitated globin chains attached to the red cell membrane. They stain light blue and they are seen in G6PD deficiency. Next one is Pappenheimer bodies. These are iron containing granules which appears as one or more small dots in the red cells. They give positive Prussian blue reaction. Next is HBH inclusions. These are round golf ball like inclusion bodies seen in alpha thalassemia. They are seen in most of the red cells while reticulocytes are seen only in a few cells. The last one, that is Howell-Jolly bodies. These are nuclear remnants in the red cells seen in certain anemias and following splenectomy. As supravital dyes stain both DNA and RNA, these structures are also stained and they appear as granules.
Okay, that's it for today. And now it is time for our Darjeeling trip. Thank you for watching this video. If you like it, then give us a thumbs up and also don't forget to subscribe to our channel by pressing the subscribe button below. And also you can share this video in Facebook or WhatsApp, whatever you want. And finally, I want to say it again, what you learn with pleasure, you never forget. Thank you.